Benefactor underwriting for this broadcast has been provided by a grant from Republic Bank, the power of red is back. Major underwriting support for this broadcast has been provided by grants from New York Community Bank, M&T Bank, Perfect Building Maintenance, Customers Bank, Collins Building Services, Marks Paneth. Additional underwriting support has been provided by grants from AmTrust Title, Bank of America, Capital One Bank, Douglaston Development Levine Builders, Flushing Bank, Friedman LLP, Handrow Properties LLC, Handler Real Estate Organization, Investors Bank, James D. Kuhn Real Estate Institute at Syracuse University, John Kessimatidis Red Apple Group, New Banks, Meridian Capital Group, Ocean First Bank, RPW Group, TD Bank, The One Stop Property Group, and these friends. I don't know, but one day I might become a urologist. I'm not going to become a urologist. I'm going to be what they consider the Babe Ruth of urology, the man who's done many thousands of surgeries and have seen many people, who is the attending urologist, Department of Surgery at the David Koch Chair of Oncology, the immediate past chairman of the Department of Surgery at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, an author, a teacher, and more important, as we would say, a mensch, Dr. Peter Scardino. Thanks for joining me this morning.
Thanks for that lovely introduction, Michael.
So let's talk about the three teenagers who came over here from Sicily.
So in the 1880s, three brothers from Poggio Reale, a small town near Trapani, Sicily, jumped on a boat, which I think were lining up at the dock, taking most people to New York, but they happened to get on one that was headed to Galveston, Texas. So the three brothers sailed to Galveston, Texas, got off and spread out over Southeast Texas, Houston, one stayed in Houston, one went to Bryan, one went to Waco, and they began to work and hard work and gained some success and sent back to Italy for wives. So they sent for three Italian young women who came over, they got married, they started families, and before long, they were running the businesses that they had been working for. So one was a shoe, made shoes and boots. One had a grocery store, and one had a luggage store that eventually became the Houston Trunk Factory. Which is a very famous place for suitcases and the like. And my grandfather was born there in 1895, was born in Texas, didn't speak a word of Italian, was quiet about his Italian ancestry, wanted to be an American only, and he went to work for the railroad. So he started out as a clerk for the railroad, then became a conductor, and ended up his career as an insurance adjuster for the railroad, and moved to Eastwood. My grandfather bought the house. It was a lower middle class white neighborhood, and he had the typical prejudices that Texans of his day had about Mexicans and people of color. And as years went by, the neighborhood changed. And when I moved to Houston as my first job as a doctor and went and visited my grandfather, he was surrounded by African Americans and Mexicans, and they were the nicest neighbors he'd ever had. They would come help him mow his lawn, take his laundry in and out, cook meals for him. And I thought it was a great turn of fate that that he became so dependent on and friendly with these people that he had been so prejudiced against in his younger days.
Tell me about your dad.
So Dad was born there in 1915 in Houston. He grew up, so he was 15 years old in 1930, and the Great Depression hit the country, but it didn't hit Houston. The oil business was thriving. Oil had been discovered early in the 20th century, and the oil business was so vigorous that everybody could get jobs. So Dad worked as a paper deliverer, selling magazine subscriptions, doing just about anything he could. He bought and refurbished a Model T and sold it, and was an okay student in school, but school education wasn't a high value in his family. And he had a teacher in the fifth grade who saw a spark of intelligence in him and took him to under her wing and said, "You can do much better than this." And after that, he began to read. He learned about the joys of reading. He began to have a great deal of success in school, and he went on to graduate from Sam Houston High School with honors, and was accepted to Rice University. This caused a big breach with his dad, because his dad saw no use for college education. He thought it was just a waste of money, and my dad should go out and get a job and support the family. But Dad was determined to be educated, and he went to Rice. There was no tuition for Texas residents at Rice in those days. He then went from there to medical school.
I really want you to tell us about your mother.
So my mother was born and raised in St. Louis, Missouri, in a subdivision called Webster Groves, which is a upper middle class, very nice area. Her family were German and Irish. Her maiden name was Mangelsdorf, and her mother's maiden name was Kelly. So she was half Irish and half German. She grew up very, very well. Went to college in St. Louis, came from a family of devout Catholics. My dad was a devout Catholic, and they met when my dad finished medical school and applied for internship and was accepted in pediatrics at St. Louis University.
How did he become a urologist?
So Dad moved to St. Louis. He graduated from medical school in 1941. And of course, that was the year in December Pearl Harbor hit, and he enlisted in the Navy. He and my mother had already decided to get married, and they got married in St. Louis in January of 1942. And Dad was stationed in New York. That's my first family connection to New York, and I've got lots more we'll talk about. But Dad was stationed in New York. They had an apartment in the Bronx, and he was on a corvette, which is a submarine chaser. These boats escorted convoys off the northeast coast of America on the way to supply England to try to keep England alive. And Dad would take the convoy halfway across the ocean and then come back and do that again. And after you'd been at sea for a month, you were entitled to come to have shore leave. But only a few days a month could you have shore leave. But Dad used to, as soon as the boat hit the dock, he grabbed his knapsack and headed home. And even if it was for a week or two until the boat was ready to go out again. And he always said, "Look, it's better to ask forgiveness than permission. I wanted to go spend time with your mother." So they met, and Dad was a naval doctor. And after being at sea for a year and a half, he was reassigned to the military hospital in Philadelphia, which took care of a lot of people with battle fatigue, what we call post-traumatic stress syndrome now. And the job of the doctors was to rehabilitate these soldiers and get them back on the front lines. And he worked with a psychiatrist there. And the psychiatrist, and he became friends. The psychiatrist was a faculty member at Johns Hopkins. And he asked my dad one day, as the war was winding down, what are you going to do next? And dad had a mentor he had met in St. Louis, at St. Louis University, named Grayson Carroll, who was the chief of urology. He had decided if he lived through the war, he wanted to become a urologist. So Dr. Holman said, well, why don't you go to Johns Hopkins and be a urologist? And dad said, well, wait a minute, Johns Hopkins is the most famous urology program in the country. They'll never let me in. And the psychiatrist said, well, I know the chief of surgery, and I know they've got to take one veteran for every one non-veteran they take in their classes. So you've got a real shot at it. Go see Alfred Blalock, the chief of surgery at Johns Hopkins, who was famous for the first successful heart surgery on the blue babies. And dad interviewed with Dr. Blalock and then with the acting chief of urology, and they offered him a job, and he came, he finished his urological training at Johns Hopkins. So it was a really lucky break for him, because he got into the first rank of surgical training in urology. And dad, by the time he was finished his residency at Hopkins, had three children, was broke and needed to make a living. So he was invited by the first urologist, his friend who was at Hopkins, to come down to Savannah and join him in practice. And they had a very busy and successful practice there.
So let's talk about the kid born in 1945, Peter.
Well, dad was at the Portsmouth Naval Hospital at the end of the war, where he was staying and working in Philadelphia. I was born in the Portsmouth Naval Hospital in 1945, September 28th, on my father's 30th birthday. His father was Peter Levite Scardino. So the Peter, different middle name, Scardino, was a tradition. And I was Peter Thomas Scardino. And when my son was born, I named him Peter Daniel Scardino. And when his son was born, he named him Peter Augustine Scardino. So we've got five generations of Peter Scardinos with different middle names. But I was born at the Naval Hospital in Portsmouth. Didn't stay there very long. We quickly moved to Baltimore, where dad was a resident. And then when I was 3 years old, we moved to Savannah. And that's my first recollections of life, is we had a rental apartment in Savannah, the top two floors of a big, an old Savannah gray brick apartment building right on Forsyth Park, the big park in Savannah. I grew up there and went to Catholic school there. And I have seven siblings in the family, three brothers and three sisters. So we had three when we got to Savannah and had four more who were born in Savannah.
Let's talk about the one time that you went into the operating room as a kid.
So I was getting interested in science in the seventh, eighth, ninth grade. And I asked my dad one day, can I come to the operating room and see you do surgery? And he said, fine, I'm happy for you to do that. So he took me over to the operating room and got me dressed in scrubs and a hat and mask and gloves. And I went in the operating room and I was nervously standing there waiting to see what would happen. And they wheeled in this little boy who must have been 5 or 6 years old and put him to sleep. And my dad washed up the area of the genitalia and picked up the little boy's penis and put a big silk stitch right through the middle of it. And I just took one look at that and fainted, right out. The nurses caught me. I woke up on the floor. and I said to my father later, don't you think you could have thought of a different operation to show your 16-year-old son for his first taste of surgery? And dad laughed about it, took me back to see him remove a man with a kidney cancer. So they removed the kidney for cancer. And that was, I didn't faint. I was fascinated. And that really enlivened my interest in medicine. I used to go hang around his office and read his books while he was seeing patients and talk to him in between when he had breaks. And I loved the smell and the feel and the whole idea of doctoring.
How did you decide to go to Yale?
The main reason I went to Yale was when I was growing up in Savannah, my parents had a good friend who was about halfway between their age and my age named Danny Zarum. And the Zarum family lived a couple of blocks away from us, three brothers, Harvey, Danny was the oldest, Harvey and Bobby. And they were just about the coolest people I knew. They were intelligent, stylish, charming, friendly, great fun to be with. And Danny went off to Yale, and during his freshman year, his father, who owned a big shoe company there, they manufactured shoes, died unexpectedly. So Danny left college and came home and kept the family business going and until he could get his two younger brothers through Yale. All three of them were Yale graduates. The youngest one was a Yale student, senior, when I was a freshman. And I have a photograph of the two of us getting on a plane to fly off to my freshman year in college. And I thought that Danny Zarum was such a fascinating guy. I'd be very interested in the school he went to. And the more people I met and talked to, the more I got interested in it. So I had a relative on my mother's side who was a professor at Harvard. And I went up and interviewed at Harvard. And he said, are you interested? Where are you interested in going to school? I said, well, honestly, I'm interested in Yale. And he said, well, that's a good school too. And so I ended up getting accepted to Harvard and Yale and went to Yale and thoroughly enjoyed it.
Theology? Your degree in theology at Yale?
Yeah, so I had been a science fanatic as a teenager. I used to go to summer schools and study science at National Science Foundation schools and Massachusetts. In fact, that's my second big connection with New York. When I would go to school, I would take the train from Savannah and get on at Penn Station and stay with Danny Zarum for a few days, going to the museums and plays and out to dinner and just wandering around town. I thought New York was the greatest city I'd ever seen. I was awestruck by it. And I would do that on my way up and my way back. When I got to Yale, I started out as a pre-med major and a major in biology. And my day was full of science courses and science laboratories. And I kept reading the courses catalog and talking to my friends. And I said, there's so many things around here I want to know about. I can't spend the whole 4 years I'm at Yale in the lab. So I switched my major to religious studies. I grew up a Catholic, and I had a lot of questions about religion in general and Catholicism in particular. So I thought I'd use my time in college to dig into it, find out more about it and see what made sense to me. But when I got to my senior year, I was lacking organic chemistry. And I said, I better get this course done if I'm gonna apply to medical school. So I went up to Harvard Summer School, took organic chemistry, did really well in it, came back and applied and got into medical school at Duke.
Okay, then you went to Duke University for medical school. And then over there, you then went to you were a surgical resident at Mass General.
Right.
Exactly. And then following that, you went to the National Institute of Health where you were a clinical associate professor and then University of California. Let's talk about Baylor, because Baylor was a very important portion of your life before Memorial Sloan Kettering.
Well, it's amazing in this country how you can move around like that, how different it is than Europe, that you can go to college in the Northeast and medical school in the South and residency in the West and move around so easy. So we had lived all over the country. And I really liked the idea of being on the coast. The Texas Medical Center is huge. The resources were overwhelming. And the chief of urology was a wonderful man. He approached me before I even finished my residency and said, we'd like you to come to Baylor and be the chief of urologic cancer. And I said, wow, that's a pretty big assignment for somebody as young as I am, but I'm ready to do it. By that time, I was 13 years out of high school. So I was ready to start to get to work on my own. And I moved to Houston, and he was as supportive as he said he would be. We started a big program in oncology, even though people said, well, you're going to be right next door to MD Anderson Cancer Center. What are you going to be able to do in Houston? But we did very well. I built a big program emphasizing prostate cancer, and we developed a huge laboratory research program and had a lot of success and a lot of fun there.
So you were, from 89 to 98, you were the professor and chair of urology at the Baylor College of Medicine. Right. 1998, you decided to come back to the Big Apple where your parents lived in the Bronx?
Well, I couldn't resist. They called me and asked me if I would come look at the job as chief of urology. The chief had become ill with cancer himself and had to step down. So it was a great opportunity. I mean, I love Baylor and I love Texas, but trying to build a cancer program when you're not surrounded by experts in every discipline that's important for cancer, medical oncology, radiation oncology, pathology, radiology, social work, all of those things are, you have to have a whole structure to take good care of patients with cancer. And Memorial clearly had that structure. It had a great reputation, and I came up here and took a look at the job and turned it down. And they said, why are you turning it down? I said, well, I'm in charge of 25 faculty member. I've got 10,000 square feet of lab space. I've got a budget of $17 million a year. You're offering me a job that seems like a corner grocer, and I've already run Whole Foods. So it's not, you don't need me. You just need somebody who can do cancer surgery. So they waited 6 months and upped the ante and gave me the resources to build a big program. And I came back, and I was thrilled that they asked me back. After I turned it down, I had a lot of concerns. But I came back in 98 and started rebuilding the program here, which had been clearly the best in the world in urologic cancer, but had fallen on kind of hard times.
And then you became, from 2006 to 2017, the chairman of the Department of Surgery. But what, during the period of time, you decided to write a book, right? Let's talk about the book.
Yeah, I wanted to write a book about prostate cancer for the public, because when I sat down with people and was trying to counsel them about what to do about your cancer, do you need to treat it? Should it be treated with surgery or radiation? What are the side effects and that everything? People really had a hard time understanding. And I've only got a half an hour, 45 minutes for a consultation, and I could spend a day teaching them about prostate cancer. So I wanted to write a book, and I tried to hook up with my brother, Albert, who was a New York Times reporter. Albert won a Pulitzer Prize for his editorial writing at a newspaper he started in Savannah called the Georgia Gazette. And as a result of that, he and his wife were invited to move to New York, and Albert went to work for the Times. And I figured he was connected, and he had an agent, and I wrote up a little précis, and Albert took it to the agent, and he said, well, you'll have to give me more than this. Give me a few chapters and I'll consider it. And Albert never had time to sit down with me and do the few chapters. So when I moved to New York, I figured this is a writer's heaven. There's got to be writers I can work with, because I want this to be a very readable, very enjoyable book. That's when I ran into Judith.
Okay, with like a minute and a half to, I mean, you have been considered, as I mentioned before, the Babe Ruth of surgeries. Prostate cancer was and continues to be the leading cause of cancer death in men, correct?
Correct.
Okay, let's talk about Judith and your children.
So I had three children with my first wife, who are a girl, a boy, and a girl.
Names?
Allison is married to Nathan, lives in Savannah, has two little girls who are in college now, Bryn Mawr and Colgate. He's a lawyer. Daniel stayed in Texas, married a Texas girl. They're both lawyers. They have three little boys who are wonderful, growing up in Austin, Texas. And I've got a daughter, Elizabeth, who's married to Greg, and they live in just outside of Boston. And she's a child psychiatrist at Newton Wellesley Hospital.
Right. You have we have a photo of you and your father, so we have the three physicians, as we would say.
Right, exactly. Lizzie, myself, and Dad. He just wanted to live long enough to see Lizzie graduate from medical school, and he did.
There was a great article that I've read on Bloomberg Markets saying this man can save your life. And I've heard from many people, and I know this, that you've saved many people's lives. You've changed their lives with the different procedures in prostate cancer, lecturing, explaining to the general public. And it's a great honor to have profile your life today on Building New York Stories. Thank you.
Michael, thank you very much. I thoroughly enjoyed talking.